Hello everybody and welcome to Dark DJ Productions. And today on Dark Tries, we're going to be having a look at this. This is the London, Midland and Scottish Railway Fowler Patriot Class 460 Express Passenger Locomotive, brought to Train Simulator by Caledonia Works. So, what is the Patriot class? Slightly confusing. Let me try and explain. So, brief history. The Patriots were designed by Sir Henry Fowler for the London, Midland and Scottish Railway, with 52 examples being constructed between 1930 and 1934 between Crewe Works and Derby Works. Sounds simple, right? Wrong. Because the first two locomotives of the class were actually rebuilds of London Northwestern Railway Claughton Class 460s. Now, this was essentially taking the boiler from the large Claughton class and marrying it to the chassis of Fowler's previous design, the Royal Scot. So you have the Royal Scot chassis with the large Claughton boiler, and this is how they gained the initial nickname Baby Scot before they eventually became known as Patriots. So, that's the first two engines, full rebuilds of Claughtons. So the LMS were quite impressed with them and decided they wanted 40 more. And they wanted to build new engines. But due to some accounting shenanigans, they were classed as rebuilt engines. They were classed as rebuilt Claughtons, even though they were essentially new build engines. They got away with this because they basically gave the new engines the old names and numbers of the withdrawn Claughtons that they were replacing. So that's already slightly confusing, but then they wanted 10 more. So these ones were classed as new build engines. So essentially you've got two rebuilds, 40 new builds that are classed as rebuilds, and 10 brand new. That's quite confusing, but it gets even more confusing because the names and numbers of the class swapped over so much. You have the names changing all the time, the numbers changing all the time. There wasn't a uniform naming sort of convention. Some of them had old LNWR names from the Claughtons they were replacing. Some of them had Army Regiment names. Some of them had holiday destination names. Some of them didn't have names, but would later be allocated names that they never wore. So that's already wild. But then it gets even worse because the LMS decided that they wanted Stania to rebuild some of the class. So 18 members of the class were rebuilt as rebuilt Patriot locomotives by Stania. But even then, basically the LMS did the same trick with that as they did with the Claughtons originally, because the Stania rebuilt Patriots were actually more like new locomotives in general. They just took the names and numbers of the Patriots that they were replacing. I think some parts were used, maybe parts of the frames, but for all intents and purposes, they were brand new locomotives. So yeah, the class as a whole is just a bit of a fustercluck, essentially, in regards to names, numbers, and build dates and whatnot. So basically, with that bit out of the way, these engines were designed to work on the West Coast Main Line, mostly on express passenger work along with the Royal Scots. They were eventually replaced by things such as the Coronation Class and the Princess Royals, so they were downgraded after that. These engines worked for the LMS through the 1930s, up until World War II, where they worked during the war. And then eventually they were brought into British Railways, and they worked right up until the sort of middle of the 1960s, in which case they were then withdrawn. Now, unfortunately, all members of the original condition Patriots were scrapped. All 18 members of the rebuilt Patriots, all 18 members of the rebuilt Patriots were also scrapped. Therefore, we have no Patriots in preservation. However, we are getting a brand new Patriot built. Now, this is going to be a replica of the final member of the class, which was number 5551. This engine never had a name in service, but the new build will be named the Unknown Warrior. So we're going to be getting a brand new Fowler locomotive, hopefully for the main line. And it's currently sort of, I'd say, half complete, maybe just over halfway complete. So we'll be able to see a Fowler 460 out on the main line again that isn't a rebuild. But even though it is a rebuild because it's a new build, You get the drift. We're getting a new one of these, basically. So, with that bit finally out of the way, that is the history of the Fowler Patriot class. Now, let's have a look around at the liveries included with this pack. We'll have a look at how it is to drive on the mainline, and we'll see if there's anything that I like or dislike about it. We'll also compare it to the old Just Trains Patriot, because that's something I would actually like to do. So, the first livery we're looking at is this one. This is LMS Photographic Grey. So this is the livery that the first members of the class would have worn in order to have their official works photographs taken. I'm not sure whether they would have run in this livery or not in service, but essentially it's the LMS lining that you would see on the Crimson Lake and the lettering and numbers, but just grayscale so that the photographs at the time would show the locomotive up better. So we're going to have a little orbit around so you guys can have a look at it as well. The only thing I want to say is that, as usual, Caledonia Works' texturing is up there, it's top notch, so it looks really nice. And it's an interesting livery, isn't it, the photographic grey? I'm not sure, as I say, whether they would have run in service like this. I imagine it would have been a real pain to clean them if they did, but it's still a very pleasant livery to look at. And, you know, it's got the white lettering on the back of the tender there. It's got the white numbering on the sides. It's got the builder's plates on the sides and the back there. There isn't a builder's plate on the locomotive, though. Some of the class seemed to have them, some didn't. I'm confused as to why they didn't all have builder's plates, but as far as I can tell on the CW model, there isn't one. But then again, there's none on the Just Trains version either, so it's not that big a deal. So we're now going to move on over to this one, which is the LMS Crimson Lake, so the more familiar one. And this one just pops for me. This is just such a nice livery for an engine, the LMS Crimson, with the yellow lining and the black highlights and things like that. So this is how they would have looked when first entering service with the LMS proper. And this is where they had their original number sequence. And this is also where they didn't have smoke deflectors, although you can add them if you want to. And you can also add the burnishing on the smoke box door if you want to, on the earlier versions, of course. You also saw there that it's got the 5XP on the cab side. That's because these were basically Class 5 engines by the LMS, but they were the XP because they were on the higher range of the power class. Eventually, they would become power class 6. But you can see it's quite a handsome engine. I love that big parallel boiler. It's a very classic look, I would say. So this is one of the examples that weren't named originally. I believe this one would have ended up with a name. In fact, it may well be this one, but we're going to have a look. It's interesting that I've put number 35 down twice, though. But you'll see that they went from the first number sequence to this one. So now it's 5535. So basically the numbers changed slightly. So this one's named Sir Herbert Walker KCB. I believe that's a name taken from one of the Claughtons that would have been existing beforehand. So this is the one that more than likely replaced that one when it was built. And again, it's the same livery, but you can see that we've got the smoke deflectors now. And you can see it's essentially exactly the same. It's just that the numbers have changed because the number sequence changed. And this one in particular has a name. So, yeah, very handsome livery. So that's the livery they would have worn through the 1930s and up to the 1940s. They probably would have been weathered down, especially when the Second World War came along. And this is where this next livery comes in. So this may well have been a livery that they wore before the war, but essentially this is wartime black. So you can see this one is named Fleetwood. This is number 5546. And even though this is even more plain, you can see you've got the highlights there on the firebox strapping as we went round. And you can see that the number has now moved above the 5XP. And it's got some slight lining around the LMS and the number as well. So it's not completely devoid of detail. But yeah, it's kind of handsome, I must say. It's still a plain black livery, but because it's got the lining around the lettering and the numbers, it still looks pretty different compared to some of the other companies when they had theirs. The only one I can think of that had a slightly more interesting livery during the wartime was probably the Southern with its sunshine lettering. But then we move over to post-war. And surprisingly, even though this is a black livery, which usually I'm not that fond of, LMS Postwar Black is one of my favourite liveries ever. So this is gorgeous, and it's really nice to see that this has been represented with the Caledonia Works one, because the Just Trains one, which we'll look at in a little bit later, hardly had any of these liveries. I think it only had like 4 liveries with it. So having the option to have the post-war black is really nice. You can see that it's still got the same lettering and numbering, but it's now got the addition of the sort of dark red lining and the highlights. And just such a gorgeous livery. So this is what they would have worn after the war. So the period between 1946 up to 1948. So really nice way for them to go out of LMS ownership. Next up, if we move back over here, we've got 1948 Early British Railways Black. So this is essentially the same as the post sort of the post Crimson Lake era. So it's basically the wartime black without the lining, but now with the addition of the BR numbers. So they had 40,000 added to the number. So this one became 45544 when it would have originally been 5544. And again, this is an unnamed version of the class. And then we've also got the British Railways on the tender. I've always thought that the British Railways on some of these ones look a bit odd. It doesn't really look Gill Sands to me. It looks more like block lettering. Somebody in the comments section, let me know. You might also notice that because it's now in BR livery, the LMS has been blanked out on the back of the tender on the build plate there. So I find that a really nice, interesting detail. So again, it's basically quite a plain livery, but it's good that we've had this one represented. And I'm sure that if somebody like me, for example, is doing something to do with the 1948 exchanges again, or something to do with that period of time, this will be a good addition to put down on your scenario. So now we move on to a very, very weird livery. This one. So this is BR Experimental Apple Green. Now, I'm not 100% whether a unrebuilt Patriot ever wore this livery. I'm sure they did, otherwise it would not be included here because CW's research is very good. The only photographic evidence I've actually seen is of a rebuilt Patriot, but either way, I'm really glad to see this one here. So it's a really striking livery. It's very lime green on my setup, but that just could be my graphics settings because I have a high saturation on my graphics settings due to filming my programs and whatnot. But this is basically the same as the BR 1948 black, but obviously it's now got the lining and it's got the lime green, but it's the same lettering and the same numbers. And yeah, it's a very interesting livery. I'm not sure that we've seen many other locos wear this. I'd love to see something in the heritage circuit. Oh, excuse me. In the heritage circuit wear this, but no, we haven't had one at the moment, but it's a very striking livery, and I'm liking the fact that we've got it in the pack. So next up, we've got Early British Railways Lined Black. And this one is number 45501, St. Dunstan's. And this one has a really nice nameplate. It's a very unique style to the nameplate. So I just wanted to show that one off quickly first. And I'm not sure how I feel about the BR Lined Black on this one, to be honest. It does look good. It's obviously up to normal standard for CW. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the fact that I'm not sure whether I actually like Patriots in BR Line Black. Of course, people will let me know in the comments what they think. But yeah, it's interesting. It's nice to see. And of course, on this version of BR Black, you can have either the British Railways lettering on the tender for the 1948-49 period, or you can have the BR Early Crest. So some of these would have come into British Railways with just the Early Crest and the BR lining, mainly because they were probably seen more on the lower scale of express passenger, higher end of mixed traffic. They probably would have worked mixed traffic at this point, actually, to be honest. So I can see why they would have ended up with the BR line black. Very nice livery all the same, very nice application. So next up, we have this one, which is number 45516 in BR Brunswick Green. So this is the orange lining, black cylinder covers, and the green livery. And yeah, this looks really nice. The CW BR Brunswick green always looks really nice. I think it's more like a bronze green, but I'm not going to sort of nitpick too much. It's either way, it's BR green. And you can have this one in either BR early or BR late crest. And we'll just orbit around just so you guys can have a look at it. Fowler tender's well modeled as well. I didn't really point that much out. But yeah, the tender modelling is really nice and it looks just it just looks nice. I mean, what more can I say, really? Then we move on to the last of the BR livery. So this is the last of the BR era. So this is basically BR green again, but this is the weathered version, as you would have seen in the late 50s, early 60s, just before withdrawal. And yeah, it's really nice weathering. You can see the alpha layer has been done on the side of the firebox there. So you can really see how much it sort of contrasts. It looks very dusty, very grimy, very dirty. This is how they would have looked towards the end of steam. And just looking at this makes me want to set up a shed scene, actually, just to show off this along with some other weathered locomotives of that time period of the LMS, because we've got the Princess Royals also have some really nice weathering as well. So that essentially concludes all the working days liveries for the class. There's only one more to look at, and I've already mentioned what locomotive that is, and that is over here. So I mentioned there's a new build being made. Now, Caledonia Works has included the new build in this pack. Now, this is number 5551, the Unknown Warrior. And this is in the LMS livery, so LMS Crimson, which is what it should wear once it's in service. It's about half ready, so it should look really nice. As you can see, it's got the modern warning stickers on the side of the smoke deflector there. You could also have it with the high-intensity headlamps as well. And if I just come up here to the front of the locomotive, just before we have another orbit round and look at the nameplate at the very least, we've got a lovely headboard up here. Now, if I can just get the camera to actually scooch over, we can read it. There you go. It's actually the same as the nameplate on the original Patriot. So, Patriot, in memory of the fallen LMNWR employees, 1914-1919. So, remembering those of the First World War. And obviously going back to its roots of being an LMWR, kind of LMWR evolved design. So we'll also have a look at the nameplate as well, because again, we don't really need to look at the livery all that much because it's the same as the Crimson Lake, but we've got the Unknown Warrior. So it's nice that we've got the mainline version on, because I wasn't sure whether we were going to get this because it's obviously not been built yet. But then again, we have got the replica of Beachy Head in the H2 pack. So yeah. The main addition is essentially the warning stickers and the fact that the locomotive is just the Unknown Warrior. And of course, you've got the headlamps at the top. So, headlamps? Why did I say headlamps? I meant headlamp, the high-intensity headlamp, and you've also got a selection of headboards as well. That's what I meant to say. So with that all being said, that is us having a look at all the liveries included with the pack. So next up, I'm going to do a little comparison between this Patriot, the Caledonia Works one, and its predecessor, which is the Just Trains Patriot. Now, some people may recognise the Just Trains Patriot as the model I use for my version of Henry in Northwestern. And there's a good reason for that. Because as you can immediately probably tell, even though it looks like a Patriot, it also doesn't look like a Patriot. Because my fictional history for Henry is he's an experimental engine built in the early 20s, mid-20s, to a design that would later become the Royal Scot and the Patriot. But here you can really see the difference between the two. Immediately evident is the textures, and the number plate as well is quite evident from the front here. So these ones are both supposed to be LMS Crimson Lake, and if we look at the CW one, you can see that it is a very clean, very crisp, very vibrant livery, whereas the Just Trains one is a very sort of drab, you know, very dark LMS Crimson. The textures just, in my opinion, don't hold up to modern times. And you can also see the number plate is a little bit big compared to the CW one, and the other big difference is in the nameplates. So this one here is Patriot, and you can see that the nameplate doesn't really hold up now. It's very blurry, even though it's supposed to be a 3D effect. You can also see, just from this angle, the alpha layering and all the modelling problems that you can probably see just on the bottom there. Yeah, you can see it's the alpha layer there that's doing that. Also, the valve gear is very odd because the valve gear looks so much better on the CW one. Let's just go look at this nameplate just to give you the comparison. That is perfectly legible and it's 3D as well. The valve gear always looked really odd to me. The valve gear on the CW Patriot looks fine, but when you look at this one in motion, it looks very thin, very spindly, and it sort of gallops a lot more. So, but, you know, overall, it does look like a Patriot. It's just, you can really tell, especially from this angle here, how much nicer the new CW one is compared to the old Just Trains one. And if I come back here, there's another big difference, which is in the tenders. You can probably see that the Caledonia Works one has a proper nice Fowler tender. It's slightly bigger looking, and it's got the frames all the way along. Whereas the Just Trains one, it looks like it's sort of, the tender is sat atop the frames. So therefore, you get this slight difference at the back here in the way they look. Especially in the terms of the buffer beam being very tall and very outstretched. So, yeah. Do I think that the CW1 can replace the original JT Patriot? Yes, I do. I believe that the old JT Patriot can now be consigned to mostly the dustbin. Not for me particularly, because I still need to use it. Because sadly, I can't do the reskin that I need to do in order to make the CW1 my version of Northwestern Henry due to the numbering. But once that day comes, I will be replacing Henry with a new model. We still wait and see what that is. But for the time being, what we've seen here is that the new Caledonia Works model is obviously far superior to the Just Trains model. You've also got many more liveries and variants with the CW1. The Just Trains one only has, I think it's got LMS Red, LMS Black, BR Black and BR Green. Whereas the CW1 has the experimental green, it's got the different variants of black, it's got all the different numbering sequences as well, and also has all the members of the class, whereas the JT1 doesn't have every member of the class and they're all separate locomotives. I think the only thing I would say about the JT1 is a child objected smoke deflector, so you can take them on and off via the bin file. So that's fun for shenanigans. So, with all that being said, let's move the JT1 out of the way because we want to look at this beautiful engine. We're now going to have a little run of the Caledonia Works Patriot over the West Coast Main Line, so we can have a listen to the sound, we can have a look at the modelling itself, and we can also see what it's like to drive. So, one scene transition later, let's go and hop in the cab of the Caledonia Works Patriot. So, here we are on the West Coast Main Line at Oxenholme. We have ourselves an LMS Patriot here in LMS post-war black. And as you can tell by the tank engine coming in, this scenario is supposed to be set in 1948. So the very early days of British Railways, where you had such an eclectic choice of locomotives and rolling stock, and all in various different liveries and conditions. So before we get going, let's have a look at the cab. And let's talk about some other bits on the locomotive. So without further ado, here we are inside the cab of the locomotive. So we're going to start with some of the camera views. So you can see, so you've got out here on the side, on this side of the locomotive. You've got in the cab here, in front of the firebox there. Back here, looking towards the regulator. Out the side, this side. Down by the wheels. Down by the front of the wheels. And then up by the front of the locomotive. I won't go through all of them, but they're the usual Caledonia Works camera views, so I'm very happy to see those. So things you can do, well, for one thing, you can bring these deflector plates in on the side of the locomotive, and you can also open up the roof vent there. You can also see that we've got all the brass work and everything in the cab here. Not all of it looks fantastic in my eye, but this butt here, this looks really nice. I really like that bit of brass work. I think it's just on the control surfaces themselves, but that's just my opinion. Everything else looks really nice. And, you know, I congratulate the team for this. It looks really good in here. So what other features are there? Well, there's obviously performance mode, which you can do with Shift P. So I'm going to put mine into max because the computer is getting a little bit old. And you can also do Control R. Turns on the automatic fireman, which we will need for this journey. And Control A puts the locomotive into simple mode, which is very handy for doing drives like this. So if I just hop back over to this part of the cab, we're going to look at the reverser as we move it into forward. There we go. We're going to come back out. We're going to get back to our side for driving because I usually like to drive on this side. And we're going to go and take a drive up the West Coast Main Line. So this is the part where I sign out from my narration. And I'm just going to show some shots of the Patriot in action along the Main Line. So, with that being said, thank you everybody for watching this Dark Tries on the Patriot. Stick around and see how the Patriot does on this drive up Grey Rig and Shap. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you later.